morning, good morning. Would you all please rise for the Baptist National Anthem, Victory in Jesus.
Four 26. Brother Chris had to step out for a second, so hopefully I can get through these without any questions. Looks like the first Sunday evening service is coming back on February 14th. So I know all the men in here will remember that date already, February 14th, and that'll be Sunday evening service. VBS training, March 6th at Carterville First Baptist, or March 13th at Mount Vernon Logan Street. Anything to add to that, Carissa? Sign-up sheets on the bulletin board. All right. Tomorrow morning, don't forget prayer group at 6:30 a.m. You're volunteering to help people get registered for vaccinations?
Yes.
All right. So at 10th, that'll be Wednesday, from 9:30 to 10:30. So if you need any assistance signing up for the COVID-19 vaccine, my mom will be here, who I have to go and fix her internet all the time. So that should be interesting to see her leading... All right. By the way, Chris could not get his iPad connected to the internet, and that's what he's out doing. So you're in good hands if you go. Sorry, that wasn't very nice. But that'll be 9:30 to 10:30 to help out. Anything else going on we need to announce? All right. Brother Terry?
Well, gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for allowing us back into your house this day, Lord.
We ask you to be with us as we go through this service, Lord, that the word you would have us to hear would come out of Chris's mouth, Lord. It will touch someone's heart and soul. And Lord, be with this country. Lift us up and try to unite us, Lord, in the best way that we need to be united. And be with our servicemen overseas, men and women that are serving to protect this country. Be with those who are having problems with their sickness now that are both coronavirus, Lord. Be with them and their families and give them the strength to carry on day to day. All these things we ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And we would like everybody to sing with us, please, and the words are up there.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide, and I am not a captive to the lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Oh, I stand in your love.
My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Oh, I'm standing in your love.
All right, well, thank you all very much and hope you enjoyed that. And they came and worked hard practicing that, and so we'll have them back doing that again sometime soon. Our scripture reading this morning is from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 30 through 32. It says, "And don't grieve God's Holy Spirit. You were sealed by Him for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, anger, and wrath, shouting, and slander be removed from you, along with all malice. And be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving one another, just as God also forgave you in Christ."
Thank you.
All right, we're going to do our praise and worship. How about we have those guys come back and do that a lot? Would we agree with that? Amen.
Leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dreamy dreams, chase your heart above all else. Make a name the world remembers. But all an empty world can sell is empty dreams. I got lost in the lie that it was up to me to make a name the world remembers. Jesus is the only name to remember. And I don't want to leave a legacy. I don't care if they remember me. Only Jesus. And
sing our offertory hymn, Amazing Grace. If you're able, please stand with us.
Now I'm found.
We have children come down for the children's church.
What's in there? Well, what's that left in there? All right. One of them just said to my wife, we're kind of matching today, so. All right, who wants to pick something out today? All right, Aiden. There you go. Be nice to me. Is there anything in there? All right. What is this? A googly eye. All right. An eyeball. All right. What can we do with an eyeball? You see with it, don't you? Don't you? You know, Jesus tells us that he sees even when a sparrow falls from the sky. He sees it and he cares about it. And he says if he sees even a little tiny bird, what happens to it? How much do you think he cares about you? What happens to you? A lot, right? A lot. He even says he has all the hairs on your head numbered. Now he has to keep changing the count for me because I keep losing them. But he sees everything. He sees everything that we do. And he looks and he's interested in that. Don't you want people interested in you? Don't you want people caring about you? One thing we can always know is that Jesus, no matter what time of day it is, it might be 3 o'clock in the morning, it might be 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Jesus is interested in you, and he sees exactly what you're doing, and he cares about you, all right? And so we need to remember that Jesus' eyes are always upon us, okay? All right, you can go to Children's Church. Give him a big hand, would you? All right, and now we have some special music again.
And if you guys would like to join us, please feel free.
Wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be. chains and wipe away every stain. Cause I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be. Oh God, I'm not who I.
I love that song. You know, it talks about not listening to the voices in your head. I watched a movie yesterday, Hurricane, about a boxer named Reuben Carter, and he had all these voices in his head about what people had told him about himself. And folks, the only person we need to listen to is what God says about us, right? He says we are a child of God. Think about that for just a minute, that you are a child of God, that he loves you and cares for you like his very own child. What a great blessing. And what a great blessing we've had today. Thank you for the music, everybody that sang. And I was just looking in the hymnal, and I'm thinking, we had music that some was written in 1790, another song that was written in 1850, and other songs that were written about 5 years ago. And yet they all had the same message, didn't they? That we are redeemed in Jesus Christ. We are saved by his grace, and through him we have victory. I love the praise and worship music. I love the traditional hymns that we have. And folks, I want you to know it's a commitment of mine that we do both for as long as I'm here, okay? So if you're out there thinking, boy, I hope we keep doing hymns, I guarantee you we will. And but we'll continue doing praise and worship music as well. All right, turn with me, if you would, to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4 this morning. When I was a very young child, I don't know, I was like 5 or 6, I would have this recurring dream that I was operating a bulldozer. All right? Nothing better than that, right? And I was just wreaking havoc with everything in my path. But it wasn't just a little place that I would go to. I went around the whole world. I took my bull, I don't know how I got it across the continents, but somehow I did. And I was destroying the entire world with my bulldozer. But right before I would wake up, someone would say to me, okay, now it's time to clean it up. And I would wake up in a panic thinking, I can't fix the world. I can't clean up this mess that I have made. You know, as I think about that dream that I used to have, thankfully I don't have it anymore, but I think that many people feel that way about the world today. That there's so many problems that we don't know how we can fix all of them. Well, I've got good news for you today. You are not called to fix the world, all right? It is not your job to put a Band-Aid on the entire world. But it does tell us in the Sermon on the Mount that we are not to hide our light under a bushel. We are to let our light shine. And so we are called today not to change the world, but to change our corner of it. To brighten our corner of it. And so today we're going to look at Ephesians 4, and we're going to see how you can spruce up your corner of your world right now. You can do it today, and you can change it, I believe, today. Look at verses 30 and 31 of Ephesians chapter 4. It says, and don't grieve God's Holy Spirit. You were sealed by him for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, anger, and wrath, shouting, and slander be removed from you, along with all malice. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we just ask you to speak from your word this morning. Lord, your words are so much more important than any words we could ever come up with. And so, God, we pray that those would resonate, that they would speak, that they would ring in people's ears, and that they would not just be heard today, but may they leave an impact throughout the week and throughout the rest of their life. Speak to us, God, through your word. May it achieve the purpose that you have for it today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's interesting that right after Paul speaks about not grieving the Holy Spirit, he tells the Ephesians to let bitterness, anger, wrath, shouting, slander, and malice be removed from their lives. He's basically telling them, hey, if you do these things, you are going to prevent the Holy Spirit from working in you. And you're going to prevent the Holy Spirit from working in those around you. Did you know that? That your attitude can prevent other people from hearing from God. Can prevent other people, the Holy Spirit, speaking and working in their life. Now, this list begins appropriately with bitterness, because the other emotions and the other actions that are listed stem from a bitter heart and a bitter mind. You look at it, anger, wrath, shouting, slander, malice, all of those come from having an attitude of bitterness towards someone or something. And I think a lot of us are like that. We've been disappointed maybe about things that have happened to us or relationships that we've had or things that people have said to us. And we become bitter about things. And we become cynical about things. And we've kind of developed this angry spirit about us. And that creates incredible problems. That's why it says in Hebrews 12:15, make sure that no one falls short of the grace of God and that no root of bitterness springs up, causing trouble and defiling many. Did you get that? Don't let one root of bitterness rise up, because what's going to happen if it does? Not just going to hurt you, but it's going to defile and hurt many. If you let a bitter heart and spirit into your life, it's going to affect everybody around you. And it's going to impact you as well. Bitterness is the root. It's the underlying hidden source behind anger, wrath, shouting, slander, and malice. Bitterness is sort of a poison, if you will, in every church or organization. When my wife orders a drink, she always orders Dr. Pepper. And I always tell her, oh, you're going to get poisoned today, because I hate Dr. Pepper. It is just a reprehensible soda. But so I call it poison. But bitterness is the true poison. It's a poison it can be a poison in a church, but folks, it can be a poison in any organization or group that you're in. I'm going to make a statement, and I think this is true. Whatever group or organization you are in, if you are a bitter person within that group, there's only two ways you can make that group better. Either stop getting bitter or get out of it. Okay? You cannot make anything good if you are bitter. You have to get rid of that. You have to get rid of it, because it is a root that just gets in and infects everything. You ever have root system get into your plumbing? It's easy to deal with, right? Not at all. It's awful. And that's exactly what happens with bitterness. It's almost impossible to get rid of. Whether it's a school, business, family, or church, bitterness is poison to the life of the organization. And that's what Paul is saying here, that if you want to grieve the Holy Spirit, if you want to stifle the work of the Spirit in your life and other people's lives, keep a bitter spirit that manifests itself in anger, wrath, shouting, slander, and malice. It's our choice. It's our choice of what we decide to let into our life. Now, I am going to tell you something. You can sometimes get your way by throwing a fit. Right? Have you ever seen that? Have you ever seen you get your way by throwing a fit? I remember one day. I was 7 years old, and I may have told this story before, but we were bowling, and I had some friends with us, and my mom was going to have us bowl one game. And I remember throwing a fit when she told us we had to stop after one. I think I yelled in front of everybody that she was a cheapskate. Little did I know that my daughter would call me that many years later. But I remember I remember getting my way. I don't know why I got my way that day, but I did. And we bowled an extra game. And to this day, it's 41 years later, I still feel bad about that. I get it. You ever get that? You're thinking about something completely else, and you think about that thing, and you kind of have a twinge of pain. That's what happens to me when I think about that day. Folks, you can get your way by throwing a fit, by stomping your feet and demanding your way, But if you do that consistently enough, folks, eventually you may get your way, but you're going to eventually push people away from you. And they are going to resent you, and they are going to avoid you. Folks, there's better things that we can do. We have to make a conscious decision to reject bitterness and the actions that follow along with bitterness. A month before the Civil War ended, Abraham Lincoln gave his second inaugural address. And he understood at that point, even as the war was coming to a close fairly soon, that the really difficult work of bringing the country together still lay ahead. And unfortunately, he would be assassinated a month later. But if only his concluding words to that address had been followed, they go like this: with malice toward none, with charity for all, with firmness in the right as God gives us to see the right, let us strive on to finish the work we are in, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who shall have borne the battle, and for his widow and his orphan, to do all which may achieve and cherish a just and lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations. Now, if we had followed that, I think most of the troubles that we've gone through in the last 150 years in our country could have been alleviated. But folks, forget about the country for a moment. Think about you. Can you describe yourself, if you're really, truly honest with yourself, can you describe your life as malice toward none and charity, which means love, toward all? Or if people would be honest about you, would they describe you as malice toward many and charity or love toward few? Folks, that's for you to decide. But be honest with yourself. Be honest and think about your relationships. Are you always getting your way? And if you're always getting your way, why is that? In your marriage, folks, if you are always getting your way in your marriage, why is that? Because I'm telling you, if you're always getting your way, your spouse's love tank is emptying, okay? And you need to remember that and think about, you can throw a fit and get your way, but it's not going to make your relationships better. It's going to make them much worse. If we're going to change our corner of the world, we have to reject bitterness. We have to reject anger. We have to reject hate. But it's not enough just to reject bitterness. We also have to do what it says in Ephesians 4:32. It says, and be kind and compassionate to one another. We have to embrace, reject hate and anger, but embrace kindness and compassion. In a month or so, they're going to have what's called the NFL Scouting Combine. And players will come, I believe it's to Indianapolis, to be measured on how fast they run, how high they jump, and all kinds of other different skills that they might have. And NFL teams will be watching them, and they will be using those scores to help determine which players they think are better than others and determine which players that they will draft in the NFL draft in April. Well, folks, we are in a Christian combine every day, with the world looking to see how we are going to perform, and with some, I think, even looking to see if they want to join us. And I don't know all the categories they're looking at, but I can guarantee one category they're looking at is kindness and compassion. Do we show kindness and compassion to each other? Do we show kindness and compassion to strangers? Do we show kindness and compassion to people who can't make our life, can't impact our life in any way? That's a real test of character, folks, is how do you treat somebody who can't impact your life? Do you toss them aside as unimportant, or do you reach out and care for them? And so we're going to be challenged. And the reason I know that that's the category is because it says it in John 13. Jesus says, by this everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. How are they going to know that we have the real thing, that we have something that they want, that they need? They're only going to know it if we show kindness and compassion and love to one another. You say, well, hey, wait a minute. We got a good crowd here today. They don't care about the crowd. We're going to count the numbers, and I like to hear how many we have. But you know what? They don't care how many people are in this room. What they care about is their authenticness in this room. Is there kindness in this room? Is there compassion in this room for each other? Now, I believe that truth is important, okay? It's what I build my life on, okay? And before I go on, Christians, be very careful to make sure everything you say is true. Be careful everything that you post is true. Don't just see something and post it. See something, check it out, and then post it, okay? Think of yourself as a daily newspaper that you read. When I worked for the newspaper, we didn't always get it right. I got stuff wrong all the time. But I was obsessed with making sure what I put in that paper was something that was true. And be obsessed yourself with everything that you put online, that you make sure that it is true. But I believe truth is important. We have to hold fervently to the truth of the scriptures, because without the truth, we have nothing. But if we say we have the truth, which we do, we have the truth. If we say we have the truth, but we don't practice it by showing kindness and compassion to one another, we marginalize or minimize the truth even as we proclaim it. You can be saying the truth, but if you're not living it, what are people hearing? Not the truth, folks. They're making a conscious decision that what they're hearing is not the truth if you are living something completely different than what you're saying. All right? So we need to proclaim the truth, but we need to also apply it. I'm going to tell a story on myself that I wish I didn't have to tell. But a few months ago, I went to Kentucky Fried Chicken to get our family some food. And let's just say the service wasn't that good that night. I was in the drive-thru line of the fast food restaurant for at least 35 or 40 minutes. All right? And it just kept going and going and going. And then my anger started building up a little bit. My bitterness was building up a little bit. And when I got to the window, I looked in the window and I saw three or four people just standing around doing nothing. Well, I found out later their computer system had gone down, all right? And so it wasn't completely their fault. But when I saw nobody doing anything, I kind of almost lost it. Okay, let's be honest, I lost it. I was frustrated, and I didn't veil my frustration all that well. Well, as I drove home, my stomach started feeling sicker and sicker, and it wasn't from the food. It was the realization of how I acted. And when I got home, I had to do what I didn't want to do. I looked up Kentucky Fried Chicken's number, and I called them back, and I apologized. They apologized to me, but probably when she hung up the phone, she was like, what a jerk, you know? And my whole prayer on that whole thing is I pray nobody knew who I was, right? Now, did I have the right to demand better service than I got? You shouldn't wait in a drive-through line for 40 minutes, okay? I had right to for that. But more important than my right to decent service was my mission, my whole life, of showing kindness and compassion to people. And folks, if we look at our rights and say, you know what, I demand this or I demand that from the people in our lives, and we skip over kindness and compassion, we're missing the entire point. Yeah, you have rights to certain things, but you also have a mission of kindness and compassion that we have to show people. Don't minimize the truth's impact in your life by embracing the truth without applying it. Don't minimize it by embracing the truth without applying it. Because you see, I doubt many of us are going to get too many opportunities to open up this book and read it with somebody. Okay? You may get a few opportunities like that. But most people are not going to say, hey, preacher, I want you to read Job chapter 26 to me. They almost never say that when I come and visit them. Or I see somebody on the street. That never happens. But they read the Bible every day when they see the way I act and the way I live. They get some version of it, at least, in their head by the way they see me live and the way they act. And I fear some days maybe that isn't a very good message of what the Bible is actually saying. Maybe it's not a very truthful message of what the Bible is saying. We need to live out the truth of the scriptures and apply them to our lives. Now, we're probably all on board so far, right? Everybody agree kindness and compassion, good thing? Good thing, right? But kindness and compassion's grandchild we're not nearly as excited about. Look with me at the end of verse 32. Be kind and compassionate to one another. forgiving one another. I got to forgive you. Forgiving one another just as God also forgave you in Christ. We aren't called just to be kind and compassionate, but we're called to forgive others even when they're not kind and compassionate toward us. In fact, especially when they're not kind and compassionate toward us, we are to forgive others. Now, I'm going to warn you. There's nothing in that verse or any place else in the Bible that says forgiveness is easy. It is hard. All right? It is hard. It's the hardest thing you may do in life. It's hard to know that you've been wronged, that you've been hurt, but that you make a conscious decision not to harbor resentment or seek vengeance against something that someone has done to you. It's much easier, right, at the moment to seek vengeance, right? It feels good sometimes, right? You have that resentment, that bitterness, that anger, and you think, boy, I hope this person really gets what's coming to them, right? Well, what's even harder than forgiveness is not forgiving. What's even harder than forgiveness is holding resentment. What's harder than forgiveness is being obsessed with vengeance. Because what happens is it takes over everything. And it becomes, it pushes everything else out of your life. It pushes out the abundant life that Christ wants to give you. And it becomes an all-consuming fire in your life and in your belly. Folks, there's not many guarantees that I'll give you in life. You got death, you got taxes, right? But there's one other that I think you can pretty well take to the bank. You will ruin your life if you refuse to forgive. If you can't forgive somebody, it will ruin you. If you hold resentment and you become obsessed with vengeance over that person, it will ruin your life. It will ruin your spiritual life, it will ruin your emotional life, and it will ruin your physical life. You will, I'm not a doctor, but I'm telling you, some people have died early because they held resentment to people. Because they became obsessed with vengeance. Because they were refused to forgive, and it ate them up inside, and it affected, I don't know how it works, but affects their arteries and their veins and their heart and all that stuff. And it makes us sick. And the other person that we have all this anger towards, they're just floating along in life. No big deal. They don't even know that you're angry with them, probably. Folks, we've got to sometimes be willing to let something go and forgive. Charles Bracelin Floyd wrote in his book, Lee, The Last Years, this must be Civil War Day or something, but he wrote about a story about Robert E. Lee visiting a Kentucky woman and a Kentucky lady who showed him the remains of a grand old tree in front of her house. And when she showed him the remains of this tree that had been destroyed by the Union troops, she cried bitterly. And she waited for a word from the Confederate General Lee condemning the North, or at least some bit of sympathy for what had happened to her and this tree in her front house, front of her house. And this is what he said after a long silence. He said to her, "Cut it down, dear madam, and forget it." I'm telling you right now, you know what you're thinking about. You know the thing that you harbor. Maybe you've been harboring it for a couple months. Maybe a couple years, maybe a couple decades. Maybe your family's been harboring it for a couple lifetimes. Whatever it is, cut it down and forget it. For your sake, not for theirs, for your sake, cut it down and forget it. Let it go. You may say, well, Pastor, if you knew what they did to me, then you wouldn't even bring up forgiveness. I've said that myself. But it kind of loses its impact when I see verse 32, the end of it. Forgiving one another, just as God also forgave you in Christ. Your sin and mine, what did it do to Jesus? Well, it nailed Jesus to a cross. But not before he was spit upon, hit in the head, whipped 39 times, and had thorns crushed into his skull. If anybody could have said, he is not worthy of forgiveness, Jesus could have said that to me. I imagine to you as well. Forgiveness, folks, is not waiting until someone is worthy of your forgiveness. You're going to wait a long time for that, all right? It is not waiting until someone's worthy of your forgiveness. Folks, if it was, I'd be on an express train headed for hell. But in the midst of my unworthiness, Jesus forgave me. In the middle of my unworthiness, Jesus said, but God demonstrated his own love toward us and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Not after we cleaned ourselves up and made ourselves good again. While we were sinners, while we were shaking our hands at Jesus, he died for us. Folks, forgiveness is forgiving, especially when someone isn't worthy of it. Dale Carnegie told about visiting Yellowstone Park. And while he was there, he saw a bear feeding upon some discarded camp food. And the bear was eating alone. Oh, there were other animals that were around, but they didn't bother the bear because they knew what would happen. Hey, you don't bother a bear while he's eating. But one animal did bother to go up and eat the food next to the bear. It was a skunk. And the skunk just wandered up to this little bitty animal, about that big, you know, just wandered up there, no care in the world, and started eating right next to that bear. Dale Carnegie said, the bear didn't object because he knew getting even with the skunk would cost him too much. You've got a skunk in your life. I've got a skunk in my life. Maybe you got a few. Folks, I'm pleading with you. Know this truth. Getting even with your skunk is going to cost you too much. It's going to cost you everything. Might even cost you your life. Probably will cost you your family. Might cost other things. That's the question I want you to ask. How much is your unforgiveness going to cost you? That's the question we need to ask. Not does a person desire forgiveness or are they worthy of it? I've had people say, am I supposed to forgive when a person isn't asking for forgiveness? And my answer needs to be yes. Because Jesus was willing to forgive even before I started asking for it. Do yourself a favor. Reject hate, embrace kindness and compassion, and choose forgiveness. And if you do, an amazing thing is going to happen. You're going to change your corner of the world. You're going to feel different about yourself, and I believe that your relationships are going to be different. And I'm even going to tell you this, that if you reject hate and anger, embrace kindness and compassion, and choose forgiveness, I believe your relationship with Jesus will change as well. It will grow deeper and deeper and deeper. Now here's the thing. Make sure it's real. Okay? Anybody can say the words, I forgive you. It takes God to help you to mean them. Okay? So everybody's got, you know what that skunk is, all right? Don't call them a skunk to your face, okay? Don't do that. But you know what that skunk is in your life. Forgive it. Now, I'm not saying that that means you have to put yourself right back in that same situation again, all right? There is something called wisdom and knowledge and understanding. What I'm saying is that you do not allow that to take over your life, that resentment, and that opposition, and that anger, and that hate. And that you let that go. And what you begin to do then, and this is the only way I've ever known how to forgive somebody, you start praying for them. And you pray for them. And you begin, what happens sometimes, not always, but sometimes, you begin to actually care for them. Because God begins to work on your heart. And God then, the Holy Spirit, instead of you stifling the work of the Holy Spirit in your life and in their life, you begin to encourage it. And the Holy Spirit begins free to work. Now, I'm not giving you a fairy tale. I'm not saying, well, do this, and we'll live happily ever after. That's not what I'm saying. Sometimes people will take your forgiveness, and you know what they'll do? They'll throw it in the garbage can. They don't care about it. Don't let that bother you. Don't let that bother you, because as long as you've put it away, it's not going to affect you anymore. Choose forgiveness, folks, because that is what Jesus chose for you. And folks, I don't know. I don't know what you've gone through. You don't know all that I've gone through. But I'm pretty sure that no one has done to any of us what we did to Jesus. Over and over. Not just you, but there's 7 billion people in the world. I don't know how many people there were before our generation. All right? All of them, all 7 billion, rebelled and said, we're going to do it our way. We're not going to listen to you. We're not going to pay attention to you. And yet Jesus walked up to a cross because he loved us enough to forgive us. That wasn't easy. That was hard. But he did it. And folks, he says, I want you to do the same thing. So you pray. You think about it. Who are the skunks in your life? Will you forgive them? Will you stop harboring bitterness to them? And will you stop holding resentment and seeking vengeance? And will you ask God to help you to forgive that person? You may not be ready to do it today, but you can start asking God to help you to be ready to do it someday. Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for forgiving me, forgiving each of us, Lord. I cannot imagine going through the uncertainties of this world right now and the uncertainties of life and knowing the certainty of death without the forgiveness of you, without knowing that you have taken away my sin and given me eternal life. But God, you know how far I and every one of us in this room have to go in living that, in living out the truth, in embracing kindness and compassion and showing that to people and being willing to go the extra mile and forgive. Lord God, we're going to confess today we can't do that on our own, God. We need you to help us. We need you to give us the strength to be kind. We need you to give us the strength to be compassionate. We need you to give us the heart that is willing to forgive, not just words that will forgive, but a heart that will forgive. Maybe even our own family members, God, that we have to forgive. Maybe our enemies, maybe our friends, whoever. But God, put that in us. In other words, God, give us your heart today. That's what we desire, Lord. Take my heart, Lord, and get it out. Get rid of it. And Lord, replace it with your heart today. Thank you, Jesus. I ask you these things in your name. Amen. Because he lives, everything else. Because he lives, we have hope today. Whatever God's telling you to do, come down. If there's somebody you need to forgive, here's the first step. If you need Jesus to forgive you, here is the first step. Come and talk with me. I'd love to share with you how Jesus can forgive you. One more verse. Just bow your head and close your eyes and talk to Jesus right now. What is he putting on your heart? Don't listen to what I just said. What is Jesus putting on your heart? Who do you need to forgive in your heart? Who do you need to embrace with kindness and compassion? What amount of bitterness do you need to start getting rid of in your heart? What disappointment do you have to let go of? Let go of it right now.